Hello, everybody. Thank you all for coming. Becky, thank you for being here.
Absolutely.
For those who don't know who I am, my name is Thomas. I'm part of the operations team here at the Esthetician Connection, and I am always so excited about these amazing learning and education opportunities that we have, because I always, even if you don't see me, I'm always in the background paying attention and listening and learning, because we have the opportunity to bring so many amazing educators to all of our amazing EC members. And I can tell you, having sat in on the back end of Becky's classes several times, that you guys are in for a really, really great presentation today. So Becky, thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Let's go ahead and get in and introduce the class that we're going to go over today. And it is How to Scale Up Your Business and Life in 2023. And in today's presentation, Becky's going to go over what does scale up mean, how to implement principles into your life that will increase your business and personal job satisfaction, what do you need to learn, add or bring in, why add oncology aesthetics, and then we will have a Q&A with Becky. A little bit about the Esthetician Connection. If you don't know our founder, Ms. Sherry Flash, she is the CEO and founder of the EC. She founded it in 2015. She is a licensed master esthetician. She has 36 plus years in the beauty and aesthetics industry. She has a bachelor's degree in business. She's a Sodexo diplomat. She's worked with aesthetic manufacturers and distributors, as well as plastic surgeons, med spas, and salons. Owned a successful skincare center for 13 years and is a director and membership for Sodexo USA. Our class is scheduled for 90 minutes. We will have time at the end for questions. Make sure you put your questions into the Q&A box. There's a giveaway that I'm about to chat about. And then we have, the class is being recorded. So if you have to leave earlier for whatever reason, you're definitely able to re-catch the replay by the link that you received to join through Friday at midnight Eastern time. And you can visit estheticianconnection.com to learn more about oncology spa solutions. And then we have Becky's full online oncology course, always available on the EC website. So you're able to take advantage of the full online training, get the exam certificate, training manual, get the tote bag, product samples, a full three-piece skincare kit, as well as a handheld LED. This is $997 value, and it's only $897 for EC members. And you can only get this special here on the EC. And then I want to introduce Becky. Becky is the inspirational founder of Oncology Spa Solutions, the author of Life Changing Aesthetics, the founder and current president of Spot On. Her mission is to educate spa, salon, and medical professionals in remedying the devastating side effects of cancer treatment. She's the premier leading educator and liaison for holistic and oncology trained estheticians working in treatment centers within hospitals or alongside the oncology team. And guys, you are in for a great treat. Becky, thank you so much for offering this amazing class. I'm going to hand it over to you.
My pleasure. And as always, thank you so much, Thomas and the EC. Welcome, everybody. And happy Monday. I'm going to pull up the screen here and get this going and get started. So thank you, everybody, for being here. I love that there's so many people here on a Monday ready to learn. That just makes my heart so happy. So we're going to talk about something called scaling up, scale up. And I know it's kind of an interesting term. It's a new term. I learned it this year, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about it and why I think it's kind of important to add to our repertoire of words, okay? So I'm going to do a quick introduction. I'm going to tell you what scale up means, and then I'm going to tell you 8 different ways in your personal life and 8 ways in your business life that you can scale it up. And then at the end, we'll have Q&A. So he already told you everything about me. I have a few new things that we're doing this year. We're adding in the soul care class that will be available starting in May, and also a hope class. So those are 2 new things. And I've been in the industry since 1978. Boy, have I seen a ton of changes, okay? But I love, 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 love our industry. And that's what's so fabulous about it, is that it always grows and changes, which means there's always something new. And if you're like me, we like new things. So I'm going to share with you how I start my year. And I do this every year. I start by reflecting on the previous year. And I was reading a book by Og Mandino called Success Unlimited. And in this book, and guys, it's a really old book. I found it at an estate sale and it just like caught my eye. I had to read it because I love Og Mandino. But he had several different authors in there. And one of the things that he talked about was how important it is to reflect or to use reflection in your life. Because if we're smart, we can use that to learn, make changes, and move forward, right? So you have to take a look at what did I do in this last year? What did I do right? What did I do wrong? And make sure you look at both. And then be willing to make changes or adjustments wherever you need to. And then, of course, always celebrate your successes. That's really important. And I do that every year. And I always come up with something new. I have entrepreneurial brain, okay? And I've been learning a lot about this type of brain. I'll tell you, and I've shared this before, for many years, I thought something was wrong with me because I never could stop thinking about things. I always have a new idea and I'm always thinking about something. And I thought, wow, what is wrong with me? Because I don't think everybody thinks this way. Well, I find out that that's very normal when you have an entrepreneurial brain. So I guess I get to live with it for the rest of my life. Somebody just texted me yesterday and said, when are you going to retire? What's that word? Can you use it in a sentence? I don't know what that word means because I'm probably not retiring, not anytime soon anyway. So adding new things and then looking at intentions and goals. So what is my intent this year? So my goal is, how can I help more people with cancer? I always look at that first. So how can I reach out and make sure that people with cancer get the help that they need? And then how can I gather more healing hands? Because I can't do this by myself. I need you all to be able to help where you are, because I saw all the places we're covered in the US today on this call. We need people everywhere in the US. Do you know that every week I get a call or an email from somebody who is looking for an oncology trained esthetician? And that could be a professional that's looking for somebody to connect with, or it's a patient looking for someone to help them. So I need you guys, all right? So I'm always thinking about how I can get more people in on this so that there is more help throughout the US. And then I always pick a motivational word for the year. Before we move on, I wanna say this quote here by John Dewey: we do not learn from experience, which we've all thought we did, right? We learn from reflecting on the experience. And again, looking at the pros, the cons, and how can you change it? So what was my motivational word for 2023? It came to me one night when my husband watches YouTube videos, you know, the little shorts and stuff. And he goes, Beck, you ought to see this. So I listened to it. It was Steve Harvey talking about some time that he got to spend early in his career with a billionaire. And I guess it was pretty interesting conversation because he was given 5 minutes and he was told if when the woman walks back into the office, if the billionaire does this, it means 5 more minutes. If the millionaire does this, it means come back again. And if the millionaire does this, it means get him out of my office. Okay. So somehow he entertained this billionaire. And he was able to talk to him for 7 hours. And the takeaway that he took was this billionaire told him that the secret to success is scaling up. What is scaling up? And this billionaire told him it would be like this. If you want to sell 3,000 units of something in a year, then you plan on selling 300,000. So you got to think big. And it just got me thinking about what we do in our life. A lot of times we play it safe, right? When we're doing our goals, we don't do something that scares us. And we already know that's where we're supposed to live, right? You're supposed to live in the scary zone. If it's not scary, it's not right. So whatever you want, whatever you're planning or whatever you're thinking, think big and then think even bigger, okay? And make that as a plan. I will share with you that when I first started doing this and teaching classes, and I taught like, you know, 12 classes a year, and then it was, you know, it kept escalating up and I was buying supplies, right? So you're thinking about buying supplies and that's an investment. And I'm buying supplies for how many students? How do I know how many students I'm going to have in a year? Well, when I started scaling up and buying big, so I buy in bulk, right? So a binder or a manual or something like that, then I'm motivated. right? I mean, think about that. I'm motivated because now I own all of that stock and inventory. And I'm not saying you should do that with your retail, right? Because there's expiration dates and things like that. But I want you to start thinking about scaling up your plans and your goals, okay? And then once you think you have that number, I'll tell you when we get to the business part. So let's say you want to do four clients, or you're currently doing four clients a day. And so your goal this year is to do 8 clients a day. I think that's a great goal. And you don't want to overbook yourself, right? But maybe where scaling big comes in this for business would be, instead of doing X amount of dollars per client, triple that. Okay. And think about, how can I triple that? Because that's the way you're going to make more money this year, if that's your goal. And that is, you know, one of the benchmarks for success in our business. We want to work less, make more, right? And what we aim for, we can and will achieve. We already know that, right? Everybody's read The Secret. Everybody's heard the law of attraction. We know that what we aim for, or what we think we will be able to achieve. So just keep that in mind. And I want to just, maybe it's a disclaimer, I'm going to tell you, you're going to hear some things today that you've probably heard before, probably 100 times. But you know what? They're the basics. And we need to get back to the basics if we really want to improve our life and if we want to improve our business. And hopefully you get one gem. All I want is one gem. If you can walk away with one thing today, I will be really happy. But hopefully you get more than that. Okay. So first, we're going to talk about scaling up your personal life. And why are we talking about life first? Because we are the tool, right? We are the important thing that probably should be insured. We are caregivers, guys. And in our realm of work, if we don't take care of ourselves, we will burn out. And I meet people all the time that feel burned out. They come to me, they say, you know what? I've been doing this 10 years. I loved it, but for some reason I'm burned out. Well, let's talk about why you're burned out. And most of the time it's because they're not taking care of themselves. You've heard it before. We can't give what we don't have, right? So if you're not taking care of yourself, how can you take care of other people? It's a basic, and it's something that we skip and we forget. I always want to tell people that you have talents and skills that the world needs. And if you're not able to share them because you're burned out, the world is missing out, okay? And it's important. I find that if you're happy and healthy, you will be able to serve better. And you know that. You know, on the days that you jump out of bed and you're like, oh, I can't wait to get back into the office today or into the treatment room. I'm so excited about this. Those are good days, right? But we all have the days where we get up and go, oh, I'm so tired today. I don't know if I want to do this anymore. How do you move past that? So just remember this, you are the only you in the world, right? And we're going to talk about that several times, because one thing that I've learned in, you know, 35 plus years of being in this industry is that people come back to you. They don't come back just because of a service or what you're offering. They come back because they like you. They come back because of what you offer, and that what you offer is different than what anybody else is offering. Okay. So always remember that you are the core of everything that you're offering. So take care of your body, your mind, your soul, and your spirit, and do it on a daily basis. We're going to talk about how to do that. So there are 8 ways: gratitude, intention, self-discipline, generosity, relationships, reflection, mindfulness, and balance. And we'll look at each one of those. So again, everybody has heard of journaling. Everybody knows about gratitude, right? But there's a great reason why we need to do this. I love this saying on the bottom, and I'm going to start with that. It's not joy that makes us grateful. It's gratitude that makes us joyful. And you know, joyful people are fun to be around. Somebody who's happy, loving life is somebody that you want to be next to. So how do we do that? So journaling every day. Again, it's a basic, but are you doing it? If you're not, I'm going to challenge you to just, you know, pick one thing that I talk about on this list. Pick one and try it and see what happens to your life when you do it. Being thankful for and looking for every lesson in life. So yes, the good, the bad, and the ugly. because in each one of those things, there's a lesson. Whether we liked it or not, there's a lesson, right? And when we start journaling, the really interesting thing is you're going to write how you feel that day, that moment, right? And a month from now, 3 months from now, you look back at what you wrote on this day and you'll go, what? I felt like that? Wow, right? Good, bad, or ugly. It's important to do that so that we can keep track of where we're at in our life. And also by writing down things that we're grateful for, which we'll talk about this a little bit later specifically, but write it down, speak it, and share it with others. So tell people that you're grateful. Tell people that you appreciate them. And then make sure that you're taking time to meditate and be still every day. And this one is really important. And it's also really hard to do. And especially if you're like me, who's a little ADD, okay? So this one took me literally years to be able to do. Okay, it was very, very difficult for me to sit still. I'm not that person. I am zooming all over the place all the time. And I'll tell you, I got a wake up call this year because I always thought I worked better that way. How many of you have said that to yourself? Oh, I work great under stress. Oh, I work great when things are really busy. I like it that way. That is just kind of fooling ourselves. Because this year, I got a wake-up call and I got shingles, which is caused from a suppressed immune system or stress, okay? And I actually thought I was handling everything okay, and I thought I was in perfect health. I did go and check it out. I am in perfect health. So guess what? I need to slow down. I need to spend more time in the quiet time again, being still, because what we think we become, okay, or what we focus on, we become. So it's important, again, to watch what we say to ourselves in our head and that we are daily writing down what we are grateful for. Intention. We've all heard this word, and I use it a lot in the treatment room. I always say, touch with intention. What do you think that means? It means thinking about your touch on that client right here, right now, without any other distractions. Because when we do that, our client knows the difference. And that will make the difference in a client trusting you and becoming loyal to you. So in our lives, intention means an aim that guides action. So there has to be action on the other end of the intention. Sometimes we have good intentions, but then we don't do anything about them. So, something that I'm checking into right now, I've been listening to somebody who has spurred my interest in this, but this person that I've been listening to got something this year called the Monk Manual. And in the Monk Manual, they suggest setting your intentions for each day the night before. So you do it before you go to bed. So that way it's off your brain and you can sleep. And when you get up in the morning, it's already set. Just a little bit different because we used to, you know, talk about doing it first thing in the morning. Do it the night before. Get it off your head. Get a good night's sleep. And then make every decision that you make needs to be according to how it's going to impact you, your family, your goals, your services, everything that you do. Okay. So how will, if I make this decision to go here or do this or buy that, how is that going to impact my core value, my goal, and my intention? And also intention helps you plan and helps you live with your values, your core values, which I think is really interesting. Always live and love with intention. So everything we do, let's think about it before we do it. Intention connects you to your core values. And I got to move my thing and makes things happen. It makes stuff happen, okay? So that's important. So have and start your intentions and then go to bed. And then the next day, follow through. Self-discipline. This one's kind of a hard one. You know, people used to say discipline was like a bad word. They didn't like it. Don't talk to me about discipline. I don't want to be disciplined. But I'll tell you, the people that I've met in my life, and I try to find, seek out, and surround myself with people who are successful, they are all extremely disciplined. Okay. So discipline is the bridge between goals and accomplishment. Kind of an interesting way of thinking about it. It's giving yourself a command and then following it with action. And I love this one. It's doing something when you don't really want to do it. That's discipline. Okay. Not eating the cookie or eating just one cookie or not staying up too late, right? Be disciplined with yourself. It's super important. It'll keep you on track. And I love this saying too, discipline is rarely enjoyable, but it is always profitable. Again, the successful people that I have met in my life all followed this path and are very, very disciplined with their life, their business, their choices, and everything that they do. And I have to say, I got to throw this word in, for my dad. My dad is probably the most disciplined person I've ever met. And he's an amazing, amazing man. And he's happy. You know, he lives a fabulous life. He's 86 years old right now. He goes to the gym 3 times a week. My mom sent me a picture of him on the roof of their house last week, which, you know, makes me really nervous. But he has always practiced discipline and I've watched it my whole life. It's fabulous. Generosity. So being generous is a key to happiness. There was actually even a study that was done that said that 77% of generous recipients were more likely to be happy every day. So people who actually were generous are happier than people who are not. Kind of interesting. I like that. And the quote on the bottom, whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. I kind of wanted to start with that because that's actually a Bible verse. I like quotes. I use Bible verses. I use whatever inspires me at the moment. And I like to share those. But think about that for a minute. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. And isn't that what we do every day? We are refreshing others in the treatment room. That is our job. We're lucky we get to do that because we get refreshed at the same time. So how can you be more generous? And what exactly am I talking about? Because it's not just about money. We're talking about other things as well. So there's 7 things on this list. The first one is thoughts. And being generous with your thoughts means giving people the benefit of the doubt. Simply said, think about that for a minute. So being generous with your thoughts means giving people the benefit of the doubt. Being generous with our words. That means try to think about words that come out your mouth before they come out and make sure that they are blessing somebody as opposed to cursing somebody. Yes, money and resources, if you have them and you are generous with that. I happen to be married to one of those. And he will, I'm going to say, over tip always. But that's his way of being generous. And I know that he's blessing people who probably don't have a whole lot of resources, and they always are so happy. I'm surprised he hasn't gotten kissed and hugged, but he does that all the time. Being generous with your time, and this one's really interesting. I'm gonna say a sentence, and I want you to think about it for a minute. Being generous with your time means being interruptible. So think about when you're doing something and you're child, your spouse, your loved one, your friend, your parent calls or walks into the room. Do you allow them to interrupt what you are doing? Do you allow them to be more important than what you are doing? This one really, really impacted me. I think this is so important because that one thing allows someone to feel special and important. It's a great way to be generous. How about being generous with our influence? All of us have some sort of influence, and the influence that we have, if we're generous, could open the door for somebody else. So think about that. You know, is somebody looking at you right now going, I want to be an esthetician and I want to be just like you? How can you help them? How can you be generous with them? Being generous with things. I want to say maybe 3 years ago, maybe it was longer than that, but you know, the joy book that came out talking about clutter in your life, that if it brings you joy, keep it. And if it doesn't, toss it out, right? I read that book And I really took a look around me of what of things that I have. And, you know, we as human beings, we collect a lot of things. When you're being generous with things, you look at something and say, could this bless somebody more than it's blessing me? And if it's, if the answer is yes, then give it away. Give it away. Share. We don't need clutter. We don't need things. As they say, things own us, right? And I'll tell you that when I decluttered my space, I got better sleep and more creativity. So there's a lot of benefits to that. And then being generous with your attention. And this kind of goes back to being interruptible, or let's put it this way. When somebody calls, give them your full attention. When you're at dinner with somebody, don't have your phone sitting there, right? Don't allow anything to interrupt the attention and focus that you are generously giving to that person at that moment. All of us have been in meetings where, or somewhere where somebody didn't pay attention to us. And how did that make you feel? So just think about those things. Relationships, supporting others and surrounding ourselves with supportive, encouraging friends. This one's really important. Good and real relationships support each other. You know, the reason this is coming up is because we live in a social world right now with social networking. And they say that a lot of people have a lot of social friends, right? But they don't have real relationships. And when we went through COVID and people were separated, they still had their social networking friends, but they didn't have the real connections. And the loss of those real connections created a lot of problems, mental health, physical health, because as human beings, guys, we need human connection. It's important for our health and our mental health. So support and listen to each other. Spend slow, intentional time together. Get to know each other's stories. I love this, in a non-judgmental and compassionate way. So when somebody tells you that they've messed up or that they did something that you might not agree with or support, you still need to listen if they're your friend in a compassionate way. Okay. Always see other people's potential, and not only see it, tell them about it. You know, tell them you are so good at that, whatever that is. I love that you do that. That is such a special skill. Tell them, okay? We all need to hear that. And I think that's something that we don't do that often. Love humbly. And that means that you might not be expecting anything in return. Okay? That means just loving with your whole heart somebody. And yes, potentially there's a door open that you could get hurt, but it's better to love and get hurt than to never love at all, as they say. And I love encourage and build each other up. So something that I've seen in our industry as of maybe the last couple of years, it's been growing and building, but I see estheticians really supporting each other. And I love that, you guys. We need to do more of that. So tell somebody they're doing a great job. Support them, ask how you can help them, and encourage them any way that you can. We're back to reflection. This was in my very first slide thing that I talked about. Everyone makes mistakes, but if we own up to them and face them, we will learn from them, we will be better for them, and we won't make that mistake again. So learn how to do that. Learn how to take criticism. That one kind of stings. I don't know about you, but I've always been a little sensitive to criticism. It took me a long time to not take it personal, okay? So learn how to take criticism without taking it personal, but being able to look at it and make the change that needs to be changed, okay? And again, celebrate your successes. Super, super important. So reflection is our best teacher if we use it as a tool. Use it. Mindfulness. Okay, so about 5 years ago, we added mindfulness-based aesthetics. This is a course that we do at a live retreat, and we teach people how to be more mindful. And what the heck does that mean? Mindfulness is learning how to understand yourself and living in the present moment, okay? Not worrying about yesterday, not worrying about tomorrow, but being in the moment with somebody or by yourself and paying attention to what is in your surroundings. So being present in the treatment room, guys, is one of the very best things that you can do. Again, your client will know the difference. And when you do this, you have connected with them and they are going to be your client for life, okay? But let's be present with our family and in our own personal life as well. That means paying attention to what's going on around us, being non-judgmental, and that means with yourself. So for a moment, I'm just going to talk about our self-talk. What do you tell yourself? What does your brain saying to you throughout the day? Is it positive? Pay attention and see what's happening. And you might need to step in and correct it, because it's super important to, when your brain throws a thought out at you, without judging the thought, dissect it. Find out, what did you just say? Why did you say that? Okay, I'm not going to take it personal because I know that I am not that. So let's start making better positive self-talk to ourselves. Super, super important. If you do that one thing, guys, it'll make such a big difference in your life, I promise. And again, we're back to being still. Find some time to be still, whether it's outside in nature, whether it's in your home, in your office, in your bedroom. I had a lady tell me that she used her closet because it was the only place she could go where no one would bug her. And she told her kids, when the closet door is closed, you don't knock, you don't mess with me. I'm in here, I'm being quiet. It's in those still times, guys, that we can actually hear or listen to our body, our mind, our soul, and our heart. And it's important to be in tune with yourself. And I think a lot of times we're living this life disconnected from who we are and what we think and what we, where we need to be. So let's focus back. Let's get in touch with ourselves again. Getting your personal life in line so that you can do better in your business. And the last one in your personal life is balance. I wish I had a picture of somebody juggling plates, because that's what I feel like I'm doing all the time. And you can't drop a plate because a plate will break, right? So you got to keep them all up and in the air. How do you get balance in your life when you are a wife or a mother or a business owner? An employee, right? A sister, a daughter, all of these things that you are, how do you keep that in balance? Number one, just make a priority list. What's most important to you? Make a list and stick with it. Plan out your days. Again, I talk about this one a lot because I still meet a lot of people that I'll say, what are you going to do today? And they go, I don't know. Like, what? How are you going to do your day if you have no clue what you're going to do? And guess what? At the end of the day, nothing got done because they didn't have a plan. So really important is to plan your days. And no, it doesn't have to be like so strict and you have to stick with it, but at least throw a plan out there so you have an idea of what you are trying to accomplish in this day, right? And then listen to your heart. And this goes back to soul care. And this is where the reason that we have the soul care class is because we all came through COVID, because we all came through some sort of trauma, because we all work with people in trauma, because we work with people who are depending on us, we have to learn to listen to what makes our heart happy. And that's soul care. What makes your heart happy? What are you doing in a day that just makes you so happy? Or are you pushing everything like that to the side so that you can focus on other people? Okay. Ask yourself that question and honestly answer it. And if you're not doing something every day that makes your soul happy, write that one down. That's what I want you to do more than anything else. Okay. Listen to your heart. And when your heart's happy, when you are quiet, you will hear what your heart is happy about. The last one is a really important one, not only in your personal life, but also in your business life. Learn how to say no. Saying no is the biggest freedom you will ever experience. It's hard to do if you're not used to it, but it is freedom. And I challenge you to add that one into your life. Saying no to something that doesn't fit your master plan. Saying no to something that doesn't fit your core values. Saying no to a client who isn't following your direction and gives you pain every time you see them, why would you keep seeing that person? Say no. Okay. So I challenge you to do that. Balance is a grounding and life-changing blessing. When we can bring balance into our life, it will literally change your life, and you are going to be so much happier, and you will sleep a lot better too. So, anybody ever heard of Nikola Tesla? Of course we have, but have you heard of his Vortex Math 369 method? If you have, you're fortunate. Not everybody has. It took me a little while to find this. So his 369 based on vortex math is what he says the energy force of the world. It's what makes things happen in the world. Okay. So it also works for what makes things happen in your world. And the method is you write some affirmations. Here's some examples of them. So always saying I am. So don't say I want to be. Say I am grateful. I live with intention. I am disciplined and make great decisions. Okay, so you can see this list here. Come up with one or pick three. And then you review them 6 times a day, speaking them for 9 seconds each, 9 days in a row. And there is magic in this method. And I will tell you this, it really does work. Okay, so 3 affirmations. Reviewing them 6 times a day and speaking them, not just thinking them, speaking them for 9 seconds at a time and doing it 9 days in a row. So when you have some time, pick 3 things that you really want to see happen in your life, write them as an affirmation and try this method. And I would love it if you guys would email me. My contact information is at the end, but it's Becky@oncologyspasolutions.com. I would love to hear what you did and how it changed your life, because I know that it will. Okay, so we're done with fixing our life. And again, if you guys have questions, we'll go over those at the end. But let's now talk about how do you scale up your business, right? Because most of you, I would say, are probably own your own business and would love to have a nice change in your business this year. So the 8 steps for scaling up your business are: keep learning, add in some wellness, add in mindfulness, creating value for your clients, creating a signature service, coming up with a niche, connecting with others, and we'll talk about each one of these, and retail sales, okay? So I would love to hear if you guys could put, let's do it in the chat for just a minute. On this list, what on this list scares you the most? Can I have everybody do that real quickly? So what's scary, guys? Retail, yep. Connections, ooh, signature services. Niche, saying no, yeah, that's a scary one. Adding in wellness, connections, retail. Uh-huh. So looks like connections and retail look like there it's the winner. Wellness is a little scary too, but I'll make it easy for you. Okay. Thank you guys very much. That helps a lot. Very much so. All right. So let's go through this and let's de-scary them for you. Don't know if that's a word, but I just made it up. Okay. So number one, keep learning. I know you guys are on track with this because you're here today, right? So always, always, always keep adding to your knowledge base. Whether you do it live or whether you do it online, whatever is your learning style, just do it. And I used to say, pick something new every year. I used to do one thing every year. Now I do one thing every quarter, and I'm even looking at adding something every month because I love to learn. Okay. So whatever works for you, find it, pick it, do it. Okay. Another really great way to learn is shared learning with a fellow esthetician. So when I talk in at the shows, and I just was in New York at the Javits, and I always ask this question and I always get the same response. I say, would you raise your hand if you, as an esthetician, get a monthly facial? And nobody raises their hand. And I think never have I seen somebody raise their hand. Okay. We all know we should have a monthly facial. We're telling our clients to, but we're not doing it. Why are we not doing it? The best thing about it is if you go and have a facial yourself, you're going to learn new things, guys. And you're also practicing what you preach. And you're also learning about new products, new tools, new services, and all kinds of things like that. So find somebody that you can share that with and start doing it. It'll really, really make a difference. And it's fun too. I always say, learn everything you can about skincare. We want you to be a skincare specialist. That's who we are. And another thing is that I find in my travels, and because I now work with a lot of doctors, guys, we know more about the skin than doctors do. Okay. I am amazed at how many times I meet a doctor who has no idea how to take care of the skin. Now, I'm not talking a dermatologist. I'm talking about a doctor, a medical doctor, an oncologist, radiation tech, those people who are actually doing things that impact and affect the skin. I'm going to share a story about optometrists who are now looking for estheticians because they deal with the eye. They need to know what to do with the skin around the eye. They don't learn that in school. So we are skincare specialists. So make sure you know everything you can about skin. Okay. So that if somebody asks you, you can answer a skin question. Always adding new skills and challenge yourself. Really challenge yourself, guys. Pick something that's a little scary, maybe something you didn't think you wanted to learn, and add it. Learn it so that you know it. Then you can decide whether it's something you want to do in your practice or not. Never stop learning. But when we stop learning, we stop growing, right? And again, we all know this, but make time for it, guys. Put it on your calendar, whether it's once a year, once a quarter, once a month. Write it down. I'm going to learn something new this month. This picture right here is a picture of a class that I just did in Barbados. And it was such an amazing class. We had 8 students, and it's an interesting country because they don't have traditional schools like we do. But I'll tell you, they learned from some really good people because they were some of the best, most intentional estheticians that I've ever met. It was really fun. And I learned new things from them. So I keep learning as well. Wellness. Okay, first I'm going to tell you about wellness, then I'll tell you how to add it in. But here's why you want to add wellness into your practice, guys. And it's not scary, but the health and wellness itself became a $4.3 trillion market in 2020. And they say it is set to increase to almost $7 trillion by 2025. Those of you who own your own business, wouldn't you like to have just a little piece of that? By adding in wellness aspect to your business. And I love this. There was a great article on LinkedIn that said, this was the title of her article. It said, wellness can transform and future-proof your business. And the reason that stuck out to me is because when we went through COVID, I realized something that happened, and we'll talk about it a little bit later in the presentation as well. But if you weren't considered an essential service, you didn't get to work. And in some states, we had estheticians who didn't get to work for 10 to 12 months. They end up losing their business. That was a scary, scary thing. So how can we future-proof our business? And I thought, for me, it was like, how can we make what we do essential so that this never happens to us again? And I will share with you what we came up with on that when we get to the end. So how do you add wellness into your aesthetic practice? Well, you incorporate some holistic or whole person approaches, right? And then you create and provide a wellness space. So make sure when you're putting together the space that your clients are going to be coming to, that it represents a wellness, peaceful space, okay? People are a little chaotic right now. They're also very anxious. So the more calming we can make our space, the better. Then we can bring in some things, depending on you. Maybe you bring in some of the singing bowls, right? I happen to have only one in my treatment room, and I just hit it once when we start our treatment. And when they're done and it's time for them to get up, I tap it again, right? But there are things that you can do and things that you can learn with that if that's something that interests you. And I always say, there's a whole list of things. Pick a couple. pick a couple that stand out to you that you are interested in. So dry brushing is another one. Choosing your music in your treatment room that is 432 to 528 hertz. So that is the frequency level of the music. It's not traditional music, but they have all different styles of it. There's a lot of science behind this. 432 to 528 is considered the healing tone, calming tones. And that's what we want to have in our treatment room. Okay, and you can YouTube it. So YouTube, just Google wellness music, 432, 528 HZ, and it'll come up with a whole bunch of them. So there's all different styles. You could do a guided meditation with your client when they're laying on the table. You could have affirmation cards in your treatment room. So every time they come, they get to pick a card and have a nice positive quote or something like that for them. They get excited and look forward to that every time. You could use Kanza wands, aromatherapy, grounding mats, Abhyanga, which I love, which is the warm oil massage that you can do on the hands and the feet and the scalp, salt lamps. So there's a variety of things that you can do and add to your treatment room. Most important, and it's not on this list, is that you need to market it, put it on your website, wellness services, so that people start looking for wellness, they're going to find you, okay? And our education for our clients still has to be this: health is an investment, not an expense. I still meet people who say, yeah, I have a gift certificate for a spa, but I'm gonna save it for a special occasion, or I don't do that except on my birthday, right? We need to start educating people that this is an investment in their health, okay? And the sooner we do that, the more we'll be able to be more like Europe and Asia and the other countries that people understand the value of a wellness service and coming to the spa. How do we add mindfulness into our treatment rooms? So again, first of all, making self-care a priority for you. See, but first, love yourself. Got to do that first, right? So we make it a priority for ourselves, so we're in the right mode when we step into the treatment room. We leave all the crap outside of the treatment room. And when we're in the treatment room, we are going to be focusing only on our client. We're going to give them our full attention. We are going to meet their needs where we can. Right? We're going to ground ourselves before we walk in. You can do some breathing or breath work with them. You can meditate and be still at the start of each day for yourself so that you're ready to go. You can talk to your clients about journaling. You can carry journals in your retail. You can have daily affirmations and talk to them about that. And then approaching each client with intention and focus, as I said, when you put your hands on them, it's all about them. We're no longer going to be thinking about our grocery list, how mad we are at our husband or boyfriend or girlfriend. Nope, we are leaving all of that outside the treatment room. And right now we are only with this client. And I'm telling you guys, it makes a huge difference. Your clients will know. Stay focused and on your plan. So being present in the moment, right here, right now. I'm gonna tell you just a quick story. I had a client that I had for 5 years, and this is when I was at the hospital cancer center. And so she was a physician's wife, and she would come to see me every month for 5 years. And we became friends, as you do, in the fact that she would wanna talk her whole treatment. And she'd like to gossip and share things with me, you know, and yeah, it was kind of fun to hear. But one day, I don't know why, but I think it was me being in a different mode. I said, can we try something different today? And she said, anything, do it. And I said, well, wait till you hear what I'm going to say. I'm going to work on you today, but neither one of us are going to talk. We're going to be quiet. I want you to experience what I do when I'm working with the cancer patients. And she said, sure, let's do it. So I did her facial that day, and I'll tell you, I didn't do anything different on her that day that I hadn't done with her before. So I didn't do anything different in the service, but we didn't talk. And when we were done, she said, wow. I said, okay, talk to me. Tell me, what'd you think? She said, don't take this wrong, but I never want the other kind of facial again. She goes, I don't know what you did, but it was fabulous. And what did I do? All that I did was focus on her. She focused on my touch and we connected. Okay. So it makes a big difference. And, you know, I always like to say too, she was healthy. Think about it. If it's a unhealthy client who's got a lot of things going on in their head, a lot of worry, a lot of anxiety, they need us to be focused. They need us to be present. Okay. But every client needs that. And if you can add that into your services, again, it will make a big difference in your clients and your client loyalty. So creating value, and this is my humble opinion, so I should put a disclaimer, my humble opinion. I, as a consumer, hate it when I go somewhere and I've booked a service and then I get there and they start adding, want to add on things. Well, do you want me to do this on your eyes? It's additional $25. Do you want me to do this on your nails? It's additional $20, right? No, I don't want that. So creating value and making it so that the client will come back to you, I believe, is having a custom service for everybody that comes in. And you cover everything they need when they're in there. So maybe that's, and I'll tell you, a lot of estheticians do this. It's about an hour and a half to a 2-hour appointment and they charge $250. That's one way you can scale up right there, as opposed to a $90, 90 minute where you're going to try to add on things. Tell them what it costs up front. If they buy into it, you got them. They're already there. Now do it and give them all the value that you can. So I always say, build it into the service. Maybe you don't want to do a big one like $250, but why not, right? Build it in to the cost and then give it all to them. So you're not nickel and diming them, like my husband says. That's a term he uses all the time. Don't nickel and dime me. We like to know what we're buying into, and then we'll feel like we got something when we get extra, right? That's how humans think. So including a hand or foot service or a scalp or an auricular or ear massage, right? Doing a little hand mask. You know, I apply the mask. And then if I've got leftover, I put it on the backs of their hands. So they get a little extra treat right there before I even get to the hand treatment. A lip or an eye treatment. Add that in and just give it to them. And then tell them this is a special additional treatment. It's all, don't worry about it. It's all included in your cost today, but I want you to know what I'm doing, right? Using Kanza, Gua Sha, or the rose quartz wands, any of those types of things. A brow or lip wax, or taking care of those chin hairs. When I was out at the hospital, I had many, many ladies who came in just because I took care of their chin hairs that they could no longer see. And they would say, yeah, I like the facial, but don't forget those hairs, right? Why not take care of them? That's what we do. And including LED in the service as opposed to as an add-on, right? So you can still pay for your equipment by including it into the cost of your service, but not making the client pay extra at that time, okay? And I love Henry Ford because he does not mince words. He says, if it doesn't add value, it's waste, okay? So think about it. Think about intentionally what you're putting into your services and how can you create more value for your clients. And I'll tell you, especially if you have a client base that you've had for a while, you give them a new facial with added value in there, they will notice and they're going to love it and they're going to tell everybody about it. If you don't have a signature service, I'm going to challenge you to create one. And this is kind of goes along with what I just mentioned, the 250 hour and a half, 2-hour service. It's you, it's your skills, it's what you want to add in there. You take care of everything, whatever that is. Think outside the box. You know, what is not being done by other spas? How can you go just a little bit further than everybody else and still stay within the realm, right? Always staying in our scope. Customized services. I think that's important. I don't believe in cookie cutter facials, okay? Because no two people are the same. No two people have the same needs. And you cannot use one product line for everybody. Again, my humble opinion, we need to have a couple of different ones because you're going to have a lot of different clients with a variety of issues. How do you take care of all of that? Intentionally plan those things out. Offer something that no one else does. give them something to remember you and come back. And the best part about a signature facial, guys, is that it's yours and you can charge whatever you want because nobody else is doing this same facial. I did a research one time and I found that there were twice as many spas in the US as Starbucks. So think about that for a minute. Twice as many spas as there are Starbucks. When you drive down the street, don't you see at least two Starbucks, right? So you know there's at least two spas, four spas in that same block. How do you stand out? You have to come up with something uniquely yours and something that you're doing that no one else is doing. Because you are the only you in the world and no one can copy that. So even if they start adding in some of the things that maybe you're doing, they're still not you, okay? So think about adding a signature service. It's one way to really scale up your business this year. And I will tell you, I'm gonna be available for consults, okay? So if you have questions on these afterwards, I don't charge for 15-minute consults. If you want to put together something and run it by me, I'm happy to talk to you about it. And this one's my favorite. Niches are riches, as they say. Come up with a niche, guys. Pick something that you love or speaks to your heart, and then stick with it and learn everything you can about that one thing, whatever it is, okay? Find out what spas in your area are not offering. Again, because if there's twice as many spas around, you want to stand out. How do you do that? So pick something that makes you stand out in your community. When you do things like, so, you know, I'm the oncology aesthetics lady. So of course I'm going to talk about oncology aesthetics. When you start working with cancer patients and start connecting with nonprofits in your area and all of that, you stand out in your community. You are now something different than the other spas. And people will talk about that. It makes a big difference. A big one that we're adding in this year is medically compromised or reactive skin. So this is not a sensitive skin client. This is somebody who's never had sensitive skin, but they're now going through some sort of medical condition and take on medications and they're having skin reactions. How do you help them? You know, learn about it. We're going to be doing a class on it specifically because we're seeing such a jump in not just cancer, but autoimmune, diabetes, dialysis and kidney issues, and all of those things, the medications and the treatments themselves can affect the skin. Learn everything you can about it. And then carry niche products. I think this is really important. Alex Trebek said, we are all experts in our own niches or niches, right? So pick one, guys. I used to say one of the things that when I went to school in 1978, it was called cosmetology school or beauty school. And we learned everything. And I remember thinking, how can I be good at all of these things? How can I be good at hair cutting and coloring and perming and skin and nails? How can we do that? I like that our industry has kind of broken those categories out so we can now focus a little bit more, but within our industry, pick something, make it a niche and learn everything you can about it. Okay. It really does make a difference and helps you stand out. So again, my niche, of course, is oncology aesthetics. And as promised, I will tell you why I think you should add this skill into what you're doing right now. First of all, I believe, and yes, I'm a little biased, but I do believe after as many years as I've been doing this, which is now 15 years, it's an essential skill. It's something everybody who touches people needs to know. Because if I didn't believe that enough just on my own, I'm not kidding you, every week an esthetician will email me and say, I am not trained yet. I have a client with cancer. And they have one of two things they say, can you help me answer this question? Or can you refer my client to somebody who's trained? And I really want to say, really, you're going to give up a client as opposed to learning how to work with them? Don't give your clients up. Okay, learn this skill. It's too easy to learn. Learn it, know it, so that whoever comes into your treatment room, you can take care of them. So not only will it prepare you for your clients who have cancer, hopefully no family members or friends. And that's another one I hear. I say, if I had a dime for every one of the estheticians who said, I wish I'd known this when my had cancer. My mom, my sister, my best friend, my dad. So why not learn it so that you know it and you can help when that time comes? I love the fact, again, that you will learn, and this is something that I teach in my course, is how to customize services for every client. So you have a service, a client comes in, they've got a little something going on. What do you need to know and how do you customize it for them so that they get the treatment, but it's now safe for them? It will add to your client base because you won't have to be referring them out. And you can let your current client base know that you do work with people going through medical issues, whether it be cancer or something else. And I'll tell you, I had an esthetician 2 weeks ago say, she goes, I do not know what happened. She goes, as soon as I said that, my books blew up. She goes, people came out of the woodworks. So again, it's how you market it, but learn it so that your books can blow up. again, helping you stand out in the community. This one's pretty important, especially if you own your own business. You can actually get some press with this, again, to make your spa stand out from all the other spas in your town. It's very rewarding, I'll tell you. And those that know me, you know, I've said this many times. I love what I do so much that I would never go back to doing just regular aesthetics, because this client is a different client, guys. This client is so much in need of what we do that they are the most loyal and so grateful. They will love you no matter what you do. This whole thing started for me with my very first client, Jayton, and that was in 2008. And I've told this story many times, but this is a gentleman who had stomach cancer. He was introduced to me by a colleague. I went to visit this gentleman at his home, and his wife was there, and we sat and talked for a moment to find out what was going on and how I could help. And all I did, you guys, was I, like a good little Estee, I brought some body lotion with me. And so I asked if his skin was dry, and he said, yes. And he put both arms and hands out for me. And so I started massaging his hands and his arms. And we continued to talk a little bit about what was going on in his world. And when I was done, he took his hand and he actually took my hand, kissed it, and he held it up to his face. And he said, I have thirsted for touch like that. And it was just such an odd thing for a client to say. I'd never heard anybody say something like that. It stuck with me, of course, all these years. I said, he said, thank you. I said, you're welcome. My lip was trembling and I gathered my things, went to my car, closed the door, and I cried. I burst into tears. I was like, what just happened? I've never had a client respond like that to simply touching hands and arms. What did I do that was so different? And, you know, I realized that it was where he was in his life and what he needed at that moment. And I was able to supply that. And that was safe touch with intention. And he responded that way. And I'll tell you, I've been hooked ever since. It's a fabulous, fabulous gig. Okay, connections. A lot of you had this on your list of scary. Why is this scary to you? Let's go through it. And let me tell you that there is a huge need. So when I started 15 years ago, this was scary. This was cold calling to like the roughest crowd ever. I actually, one time in a hospital, had to walk while the doctor was walking because he wouldn't even stand long enough to listen to me. He said I could talk to him, but I had to walk with him. Okay, so yes, it was scary. But let's fast forward 15 years. Now we have doctors and hospitals and cancer centers and all of these on this list reaching out to me, asking for oncology trained estheticians in their area. They want them. So it's a whole different ballgame now. Now we know we're needed. Now we know that there is an opening, and it's a whole lot easier. So physicians, oncologists, radiologists, if you're going to work with oncology aesthetics, you're going to want to connect with them because then they will refer their clients to you. Chiropractors, same thing. Wellness industry, you can connect with them. They don't work with the skin. They would love to have somebody that can help their clients, their patients with their skin. Optometrists, this was a new one. And I did a webinar on it a week ago with an optometrist who actually came up with something called optometric aesthetics. Because in her industry, all of the ophthalmologists are on this group call going, what do we do about the skin around the eyes? You know, when we put these drops in, when we put these meds in, we get this reaction and this dries out. What do we do? My clients are coming to me asking about the wrinkles around my eyes because they're an eye doctor. And the optometrist never learned this. So they are looking to add estheticians to their practice. That was like mind-blowing to me. There's a new one. Physical therapists, because they're working with clients, again, who have special needs, but they don't take care of the skin, and they love to have someone to refer their clients to. Lymph specialists, same. Wellness centers, a lot of wellness centers are opening. I get calls for consulting, actually, with them on how to put together their business and how to add in aesthetics, okay? Nonprofits, you can reach out to them because pick one that works with whatever you're working with. When you are oncology trained, pick one that's within the cancer realm, then offer to go in and talk about skincare during cancer treatments. All of these things are needed and they want it. So it's kind of a warm call now, maybe even a hot call in some spaces, but not a cold call anymore, and it shouldn't scare you. Again, I'm available for coaching and consulting if you're scared and you want to reach out and make these connections. But guys, it will make the difference in your business. When I first started at the cancer center, I didn't have any clients, right? I was brand new there. I didn't know any of the patients. My doors open, but I didn't have anybody. I had to go and reach out to these doctors and nurses and medical teams. And when I did that, it made a big difference. But I'll tell you what made the biggest difference is when I invited them to come in and have one of the services that I would be giving their patients, they got to experience it. One nurse within that very day, she sent me 9 people because now she knew what we were talking about. Okay. A lot of times, and I find this a lot in the medical industry, they don't go to the spa. They don't take care of their skin. So when they've never had a facial, maybe. So you invite them in, show them what you can do and talk to them while you're doing the treatment so that they understand what you're doing, being quiet when you can. And that will get you referrals and it will really help you build your business. Within the spa, if you can connect with hairstylists, nail techs, massage therapists, acupuncturists, any of those, again, do not work with the skin specifically, but their client, remember, we're a whole body. When you get a client on the table that you really care about and you're helping them with their face, if they ask you about who can I go to for my hair, or who can I go to for my nails? If you know somebody, you're going to refer them, right? So it only makes sense. You get some good cross-marketing going and hopefully people will reciprocate. You want that. You want them to be able to send referrals back to you as well. And when you're looking for the connection, so you go to a doctor's office or whatever, do the research first. Look them up. Make sure they don't already have an esthetician, okay? Scott Pifferman says, if you can connect people, you can create the future. So let's do connections to create your future and increase your business and scale it up. Some connections of my grads. So I have lots of grads working in cancer centers. I have them working with cancer centers. So they're not necessarily working for them. Some of them are, but some of them don't. They just get referrals. They work with hospitals in a hospital spa. And a lot of spas are being put into hospitals now. Wellness centers, plastic surgeons, massage therapists, as I said, and then wig stores and nonprofits. You want to get as many people connected to your business that you can that makes sense to your goal, your mission, your core values, okay? And it only makes sense because, again, we're a whole body. They're looking at them. Like I had somebody the other day tell me they're a lash specialist. Okay. And she goes, while I'm doing somebody's lashes, I'm looking at their face and it's like bad. And I'm asking them, do you ever have a facial? And they say, no, tell me about it. Right. So that particular lash specialist didn't do facials, but she had someone she could refer them to. So just think outside the box. Okay. Because we all have people we can refer our people to, hopefully, and that will refer back to us. One of my clients said to me one time that the touch and care that she received from me is what kept her going when she wanted to give up. You think about that for a moment. You know, something simply that we do every day in our treatment rooms is something that made this person feel like they could keep on going. We have value, guys. Retail. This is the one you guys said was scary. And I know, I remember thinking that too in my earlier years in the industry. But do you know that they say that we should have greater than 50% of our monthly income should be from retail sales? And rarely do I find an esthetician who is actually doing that. So this is where you're going to scale up. You're going to say, right now, I'm only selling X amount a month. I'm going to scale it up and start planning to be able to sell, making 50% of my income in retail. You should be able to do that. And I'll tell you, the people during COVID who actually already had this in place made a living all the time their business was closed because they were able to send and get products out to their clients the whole time. Okay, it's important. One thing that is important is having exclusive retail, something that they cannot get on, I'm not going to use the name, but that you can't get somewhere else. Okay, have something they can only come to you for. And then make sure you're educating your clients on the benefits or solutions, not telling them what's in the product. Now, they will ask you that and you should know it. But nobody buys something only because of what's in the ingredient deck. They're going to buy if it's going to do something for them. Okay. So learn the benefits, and that's how you educate your clients. They will buy without you even having to ask them. And another thing that's really important is learning how to order properly and how to inventory every month so that you're not having a bunch of products sitting on your shelf that you're not selling. So you start small, you pay attention to what you sell. And there's a method to it. I was a buyer at Nordstrom for 8 years. So again, I'm available for consults if you want to reach out and find out how to learn more about how to order, how to inventory, and what you should be doing. Always too, I see this mistake happen a lot in new businesses where they'll buy the shiny stuff, okay, the new big piece of equipment, and then they don't have money for anything else. I always say, start with the basics and the shiny stuff can come later, okay? And then learn how to market and learn how to market yourself. That's really, really important. Zig Ziglar, I love this quote. Selling is not something you do to someone. It's something you do for someone. And I see this play out all the time in the aesthetics world. We talk about skincare while they're in their treatment. And then if we forget or we never mention products to them, what are they going to do? They're going to go either stop at the drugstore on the way home and buy something, or they're going to go home, go online and start researching. Why would we do that to our clients? If you have them on some sort of regime and you want them to be compliant, they need to have the proper home care. Do not be afraid of selling. Remember, it's not something you're doing to them. It's something you're doing for them. So you are helping them learn how to educate and sell benefits, and you'll be much better on the retail. Okay. This is our new logo and label, actually, for our products that we've had out for 3 years. So this is the oncology skincare line. And this line was made for medically compromised and reactive skin. This product line is going to be highlighted in a wellness magazine coming up here real soon, because this wellness magazine, and it's not our industry wellness, but outside of our industry, contacted me and said that so many clients have been asking them about my line that they wanted to do a story on it. So marketing is super important, okay? When you have somebody who's medically compromised, whether they've got lupus or they have diabetes or they've got, they're on dialysis, they're gonna have some skin issues. They need the right products for the right time. Okay, so we'll talk about this, but they're really fabulous. We've had them out for 3 years. We tested them with cancer patients initially for almost a year. And then we've had it out for 3 years since, and it's doing really, really fabulous. But this is a way for you guys to scale up your business. The easiest way for you to scale up your business is to learn how to retail products. Okay, And it should be products and accessories, things that they need for wellness. So I have a final thought that I want to share with everyone, because I got an email yesterday from Express Spa that says, get a mani in minutes done by a robot. I was shocked, to say the least. I mean, I'm sure I knew it was coming, but I was like, are you kidding me? I sent it to two of my nail people and I said, I don't even know what to say. And my nail companies said, yep, it's a thing, it's happening. So do we think that we're gonna be replaced anytime soon by AI? I'm gonna say not on my watch and hopefully not on yours either, because I really believe that what we do is essential. We are essential workers. We are an essential service. And we need to do a better job in this year marketing ourselves that way. Okay, really important. I'm going to say, God forbid we ever have to go through anything again like we did in 2020. But, you know, who knows what's going to happen in the future? Why not future-proof your business now by marketing yourself as an essential worker? And I'll tell you, there's tons of studies. And if you want them, again, send me an email. I will send them to you. But what we do makes a difference, okay? We bring value to the world. Not only do we make people feel loved, important, cared for, and connected, but we can actually, with our touch, relieve pain, reduce anxiety, lower blood pressure, and really much, much more. So never underestimate what we do and the power of touch. And I am done talking. So, who has questions? Looking forward to new added classes. Me too. I can't wait to roll them out. I have so many people who responded well to the soul care class because we all need it, guys. Not only did we come through trauma, some of us more than others, but we are dealing with clients with trauma and we need to know how to help them on a holistic level.
Should there be separate services specifically for oncology clients?
Yes. So there could be special ones, but I actually prefer learning how to customize what you already do for them specifically. So that would mean maybe adding in a few steps or not doing a few steps, but we teach that so that you learn how to take what you are already doing to customize. I don't like to use the word modify, but to customize a service for somebody. And when someone's going through cancer, they want to feel normal, right? So we don't want to call something a cancer facial. We want to invite the clients in and have them feel normal, like they're having a normal spa wellness experience. Okay, I think that's most important. Somebody's repainting the spa. So yes, there are a whole realm of colors that are more relaxing. So it's more to the warm side, just so you know. And I have a friend who does that. So if you want, you can email me and I can connect you with, and she can tell you what kind of colors might be good for spas. How do we treat cancer patients' skin differently? Well, they have different issues that they're dealing with. They have a very reactive skin. It could be hot skin. So we need to calm, soothe, hydrate, and protect. Those are our goals. And again, each person will be different depending on the medication and what they're going through. All right, so how do we get certified for oncology aesthetics? So we have three different options. Right now, I think the full option is on, which is the best, and that is on the EC's website, and it's also the very best price. It's $100 off. It's all online, and the theory is online, I should say, and it is at your own pace. So you go through the modules on your time and at your own pace, going back if you need to, watching them again, whatever you need to do. And when you're done, we have a one-day live clinic, and we have those listed on the website. They are in various places around the U.S. And then, of course, you have to take an exam, and then you're certified, and you are good to go. Do you have a refresher course? Yes, I do. So you can reach out on the website, course tab, click that, and then go down to recertifying or refresher. For someone who primarily does facials and no other services, what would be your first idea as far as incorporating wellness? Again, I would think about adding in some of the wellness tools and some of the wellness steps into your massage, like the Abhyanga and things like that. And then, you know, the other things are on the list and you'll get to see those. Let's see, Lisa, I'm a certified nursing assistant and at the end of life. Oh, wow. An esthetician part-time. When is this class for medically fragile come out? Should I take oncology? So that is the oncology course. We do talk about medically fragile in that class and you learn everything there. The other two classes will be out in May, the Soul class and the Hope class. LED light benefits with oncology. Okay, so LED has one contraindication when it comes to cancer, and that is, are they on a medication that causes photosensitivity? So we need to look their medication up first. If they are on a medication that causes it, no LED, not until they're done with their treatment. If they're not, so let's say they just had surgery, then LED is fabulous for helping the scars. If they are having just radiation and not, it's fabulous for helping the take the inflammation down from radiation therapy. So there's several different applications for LED. Do you price your services differently for oncology? I do. I always say price it significantly lower. And that does two things. One, it makes it more affordable for a cancer patient, but it also helps a doctor be able to give you referrals. And when you're talking to the doctor, you say, my facials are normally $250, but for the cancer patient, they are $150, or they're normally $150 for everybody, and I charge $75 for a cancer patient. So they understand that you're not trying to make money on their patients. This is a really big, important note. Pay attention to that. Doctors do not and won't send you referrals if they think you're just trying to make money on their patients. So yes, we do price them a little bit different. So is it a matter of ingredients in your products that you use that makes a difference? Yes, absolutely. It is all based on ingredients, okay? And it meets the goal of protecting, calming, soothing, and hydrating. Let's see, I'm looking into the oncology course of just theory and manual. Is there, or do you offer a promotion for this course? So we haven't done that, but we always give a discount to EC members. So when you want to take that class, send me an email because we don't have that special going right now, and I'll make sure that you get a special discount. Canadian students, where do we get the live training? Oh, Elaine, that's tough. I guess you're going to have to come to Seattle if you can. I'm not sure where in Canada you are, but we have them in New York, and we also have them in Seattle in the Renton area. That's all. We don't have anything in Canada yet. I have a school in Canada that we just started working with. So maybe there's something in Quebec that might be happening in the next year. So stay tuned. Your socials and contact information, please. Let me move it. It's on the next page. There we go. All of my information. Thank you. If we were originally certified through another, can we take the refresher course through you? Yes, I allow that. Absolutely. And do you need a different insurance to do oncology aesthetics? If you are insured with ASCP, they cover it without any additional cost. For pricing, are you able to get set up to take FSA and HSA payments? Oh, I didn't talk about that. Yes, we're actually working on something like that. So stay tuned. This year, hopefully we'll have something out for that. Can IPL laser be beneficial for cancer treatments or inflammation or scarring? No, not during cancer treatments, but 6 months later down the road, then that's something that you could take a look at. Fillers pertaining to clients that takes a preventative medicine after breast cancer treatment. So as far as I know, that is not a contraindication because she's probably on tamoxifen or something like that. No contraindications known at this point for fillers for somebody who is on that. And we wouldn't do it while they were on chemo or active cancer treatment, but later on down the road. Do doctors or the esthetician world view the Sedesco versus your course at different levels? They don't know what Sedesco is. They don't know what we are. So our education to them is whatever we present to them. So at this time, anyway, that's kind of where we're at. So we need to do a better job of educating them, right? Is Hale and Hush recommended? So there are some of the products in Hale and Hush that can be used on cancer patients, but not the whole line, which is why we made the whole line, because we needed to have a whole line that could be used. So yes, there are some. And I would check with Chris Campbell on that to see which ones would be safe to use on cancer patients. Wow.
Becky?
Good question.
Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you, Thomas.
As always, the full oncology course is always available on the EC website and exclusive EC member pricing. So you can definitely take advantage of that. So thank you everybody for attending, and I look forward to seeing you in our next class.
Thank you, everyone. Have a great week.